before Christmas.
So looking forward to that. Yeah. And now we, so yeah, yeah.
Are you currently using in those systems, is it only the standalone music server, or are you also doing other tricks behind that? For instance, power supplies on certain filters or routers or a specific device behind the music server, or is it just music server plugged into the wall and then USB out mm-hmm. into your dock?
It depends a little bit. I do it all. I have an Audio Quest Niagara 5000.
Yes.
And a PS Audio P20.
Okay.
And direct to wall. And I do have several sort of power distribution boxes. So you do basically have to test it with everything. And the server having a larger transformer is probably the main reason for it than a regular source component. Behaves more like a power amplifier. So if you have an Audio Quest Niagara, you would use the high current outputs. Same for the PS Audio P20. Or directly into the wall, whatever you prefer. But it behaves more like a power amplifier. The sort of depends. If you only play small scale jazz and stuff like that, you won't really notice any differences. Actually, the smaller prototype models sound nearly as good as the Extreme Server with that sort of small scale performances. But if you have anything larger scale, massive orchestral performances or everything, then it sort of falls apart. If anything get really, really busy, then it falls apart on the power supply, or the power supply, the power feeding the server. So that's definitely something to consider. Yeah.
So do you also, for those that are current or want to be future owners of the Tyco Music Server, do you advise on power cords? What's your advice on power cords, footers, isolation devices? What have you found within your rooms that, you know, you like to do, you like to see people do with this?
Definitely use power cords made for power amplifiers and not for source components. Okay, great.
You did tell me that, right.
Yeah. And and then it's a little bit up to taste. So yeah, you have people using Nordos power cords, Siltec, Crystal Cable Connect, Shunyata,
yep.
Audio yeah. Quest.
Got it.
It's really all over. So there is this sort of personal preference you may have. And it just works. It sort of introduces the same differences as on any other device in your... it's not like this server needs a specific power cord or something. It's, from my point of view, every component in your system needs that. And of course, you can ignore all of that and just use standard power cords.
Here,
it will work. It will work. Yeah.
Here is a question that I have for you. I was having a conversation a few weeks ago with a friend of mine with regards to power cords, and one of the arguments was, from my end, is why don't high end, especially these brands that we're talking about, why don't they include at least a decent power cord, whatever that may be? The only brand I can think of right now that I have personally owned, again, and there might be others, but the only one I can think of that has included an aftermarket power cord was the Dan D'Agostino Momentum line that came with a transparent power cord. So kudos to Dan and his team, for including an aftermarket power cord. My argument has been this: if you, and I'm not saying you personally, I'm saying as a manufacturer, right? If a manufacturer builds a product that is said to be incredible, but it's kind of quote unquote incomplete by not having the proper power cord needed to really elevate it to its full capacity, it would be like buying a Ferrari and the Ferrari coming with only four cylinders and you needing a spare key to turn activate the other four cylinders. Does that make sense? So I've always felt like, shouldn't a decent, not a top-end power cord, but a decent power cord that at least gets you going in the right direction be included with some of these brands in general? Again, I'm just posing the question to you. How do you feel about that argument? Because I've had it with a lot of different dealers, friends of mine, where they're saying it sounds terrible until you put a $10,000 power cord on the amplifier or preamplifier. But to me, it makes me, I guess you could say, a little sick to hear that, because I have had components that I have literally used a lamp cord, for lack of a better power cord, plugged them into the wall, and I was just like, wow, immediately the raw talent is there in front of you. And now that gets you to go and buy a power cord and elevate it to greater heights. How do you feel about that? How do you feel about including, and I understand power cords are very, it's like a taste thing. It's like, how do you like your wine to be? It's kind of like that, right? You got to let the end user select. But what's your take on that? What's your take on power cords being included?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. And I have to say, we thought about it a lot to include one. Now, obviously, it has a little bit of an effect on the retail pricing. If you of want course. To include something decent, I'd say we'd include something like a minimum of, say, an Audio Quest Hurricane. That's actually sort of reasonably affordable power cord relative to your system, which works really well. And I actually use those myself from time to time, or a lot of that. The thing is, suppose we include that and raise the retail a little bit, then actually 95% of our customers would throw it away anyway. So it's a little bit.
Yeah.
But I think it's also tied to the price of the product. It's a little bit higher, and the people buying our servers, they're already spending on power cords. I don't think we have any customers who do not invest into their cabling. I seriously think not one. So they do their own thing anyway, and some of them spent almost the equivalent on the server retail price on their cabling accessories surrounding it. Sometimes even more. You can actually spend more, but almost everyone buy something other different anyway. But you know, there should be one.
Here's what I'm thinking. And there was a conversation from a cable brand that will go nameless. They were trying to work out a deal with a very, very well-known American brand, and they were trying to figure out a way to include aftermarket power cords with this, with their amplifiers and preamplifiers. And obviously, if a deal was to be made between two brands, the cost associated to you as a brand, as a manufacturer, is a lot less than it would be to an end user. So the power cord, let's say, retails for $3,000. Clearly, whatever dealer cost is on that particular power cord is going to be less for you, because you're ordering now far more to sustain your business model. So I personally think that at some point, and of course, to your point, a lot of us who have this high end are going to have great cabling, no question about it. But I do believe that it leaves out that one particular audiophile that has saved their money, and their dream was to own your machine one day, and they have saved for a long time to buy it, but now they have to go out and still buy another power cord for another whatever $3,000. And so that's kind of like, I guess that would be more targeted towards that individual that can buy your machine, but they're doing everything they possibly can to save their money and their pennies to buy it. They just want to make sure they get the best sound for, you know, what they can afford. I mean, that's the reality of it. Not many people can go out and buy your machine and then buy a $10,000 or one to buy a $9,000 Shinata Omega power cord, for instance, right? Or an $18,000 Nordos Odin 2 power cord. Yes, of course, the demographic that your machine, you know, applies to, the systems where it's found, typically, are systems that have the resources to buy a great power cord. But I think, and not just your machine, I'm saying general terms, at least a good, whatever that may be, power cord, in my opinion, should be part of these products to get the user to at least say, I'm happy and eventually I'll get to a power core, but I want to just be blown away. And I am blown away with what I'm hearing right this second. And I hope that, you know, when with me saying this, a lot of brands out there begin to really, really consider that. Because I think, for instance, I go back to the Dan DiAgostino Momentums. When I use standard power cords, I didn't like what I heard too much. It sounded good. But when I used the transparent, it was a game changer. Like, and it's not even the expensive transparent power cord. I mean, it is like $1,500 MSRP power cord, something like that. And it was incredible what I heard. So I'd like to see a little more of that with different brands. Because remember that it's sad to say this, but a lot of times when a product gets out in the field, a lot of reviewers do this. A lot of the big magazines do this. They'll use their own power cord and then analyze it based on whatever they had, right? And then what happens is they're not giving an accurate presentation of your product because now they're using a mismatched power cord for whatever they may have, may not be the best power cord for your machine. But if you include a good sounding to your gears, a good power cord that you believe represents great sound coming out of your machine, then you could say, please use the power cord that we include because we believe it's the perfect balance. Now, if they want to go on their way and use a different power cord, that's on them. But using the standard stock power cord, to me, a lot of times mitigates the performance factor of any component. Does that make sense? If one of the things I've been doing lately is reading reviews and looking at the associated equipment. So you'll have a speaker, as an example, just let's say a speaker that's 60,000 USD. And then I look at the amplification where they say the bass on the speaker was a little loose. The bass was not as tight as I'm typically used to. But then when I look at the amplification, I mean, I look at an amplifier, the damping factor is not all that great. It's not really a powerful amplifier and known to have grip. So it can create confusion. And I think a lot of these people that review equipment lack that common sense of saying, is it the speaker or is it your setup that is not well matched for my device, including your music server in this case, right? Because your music server can sound amazing and it does sound amazing. But when you take that music server and you insert it in the wrong system, it's not guaranteed to really swim the right way. It's not guaranteed to flow and perform because it's a poor mismatch. It could be cables, to your point. It could be power cords. It could be so many different variables that sometimes are often overlooked, actually. A lot of these things are often overlooked with reviewers.
So part of our support package is actually ensuring that it works well by helping people out if they're not satisfied of the boot. So we actually, the thing what we're doing right now is just guiding people around what they have, what they're using, and to pinpoint, that's not going to work that great. And a lot of people, also people buying from dealers, contact us directly ahead of purchase and just say, hey, this is my system. What should I do to get the best out of your music server? And we write back, so we respond to that. So we do have a significant email volume, so we respond
do,
instantly to sort of people needing immediate support. And sometimes it can take a day or something if it's a less urgent sort of email, and which takes some time to write a reply to. But we do support everything, including how to get the most out of it. And yeah. That's what we try to do. And it's the silly thing is you just mentioned the Relentless. So you think, hey, that's a seriously expensive amplifier. Shouldn't that be less sensitive to power cords? Well, my experience sort of is the more expensive the stuff is, the more sensitive it is to power cords. Or maybe perhaps it just reveals more of what that power cord does, open for argument.
Yes.
But that's the thing. And we've been immune, trying to make it immune for a lot of disturbances which are on the power grid all the time. But it's the power grid is connected to your system.
Correct.
And there I'm back again saying that everything connected to your system has an influence on sound, and the power grid is an incredible. It's connected to your system. It matters. Your utility box matters. Your in-wall wiring matters. It all matters.
Absolutely. Have you experimented with battery power conditioners? Have you experimented with like the Strom tank from Germany, for example?
The bigger ones do a very good job. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That is something that I am in highly contemplating for myself, a battery power conditioner, just to see, to basically disconnect me somewhat from the grid. The unfortunate part of this is that these battery power devices sometimes cannot really handle massive power class A amplifiers, right? It's just very difficult for them. Of course, there's always going to be one that claims that they can do it all and they can have no problem with the amplifiers, but I've never heard a power conditioner out there that can really improve the performance of big power amplifiers, Boulders, Griffins, big power supply amplifiers. I feel like the dynamics are compromised. The soundstage sometimes begins to get a little narrower. There is a lot more resolution, no question about it. You'll hear even deeper into the presentation at the expense of a huge presentation, lacking a huge presentation, or even, again, the explosiveness that I'm a very, very, I'm big on dynamics. I'm big on that explosive factor that makes me jump out of my chair. And one of the things that I've noticed is anytime you go into a power conditioner, some of that is always mitigated. That jump factor gets lesser. It's almost as if you apply room correction. You know, there is surround sound processors have this mode that is called night listening mode, which basically compresses the dynamic peaks of the explosions, right? The movie, it makes them a little flatter so there's no up and down. It feels like that. It feels as if the dynamic peaks are just completely brought down so everything is more uniform. So you lose that ability to hear speed, in my opinion, impact. That's one thing I just hate with music, because I feel music needs to have that in order to be fully enjoyable. So I am planning, of course, like I said, to bring something like that with a battery power conditioner.
I think it's the future. Yeah.
You think so, right?
Power quality is degrading. It's just the fact that we have much more solar power, power inverters, home power packs, electrical vehicles which need to be charged. The power grid here is absolutely stressed.
Yeah.
And it's not helping.
Yeah, it's not, definitely not. Yeah.
Let's say where I did not like a PS Audio P20 power generator a few years ago. Now I'm thinking it's not that bad a tool, especially during specific parts of the day. But still, you're still not there. So I think. So battery power is something which may become a part of our lives anyway.
I agree, definitely. Absolutely.
For Strom tank, etc. So get on it, guys. And I think they're already doing a pretty good job, because the bigger models at least do a fine job. Obviously, you'll be spending quite a lot on those, but the smaller ones are. But I'd say the advantage of those kind of solutions are going to increase over time, not decrease. So it may be a sound investment for the future, where your performance versus the declining quality of your power grid is going to make those more significant products. And again, you still need power cords.
Just as a joke. You still do. So are you of the belief that power cords are the most important cable in the system, or would you say it's speaker cables?
I think actually every cable is important, but I think the effect of, if you have, say, a silver or a copper power cord, and just general speaking, that silver is a bit leaner in the base and a bit brighter on top, very, very generalized, then I'd say you hear that effect stronger on power cords than on interconnects or speaker cables.
Agreed.
That's a little bit. And if it's because cable manufacturers take more care of of making that more neutral for interconnects or speaker cables. I don't know exactly, but I do know it's just much more pronounced in power cords. So that sort of makes power cords.
Is it for you? Is it safe to say, if you were, and to your point, of course, I know that every cable matters, everything matters. Would you say, in order of importance, would you say power cords, speaker cables, and then interconnects, as far as how you view them in a system and their impact?
Well, actually, I think I would spend most of my power cords, yes.
Okay, okay. I cannot disagree with that, because sometimes I go back and forth between speaker cables and power cords. I'm still one of those that spends more on speaker cables than power cords, unless, of course, you add up all the power cords you need, then, of course, it tends to be more than the speaker cables, right? Because that's only two cables. But I would say, speaker cables first, power cord second, interconnects third. My reasoning is the last cable that your system sees is the speaker cable. So if that is your bottleneck, no matter how many power cords you have, the speaker cable can completely negate the effects of a lot of those power cords. For instance, if your speaker cable, let's just say, I go back to Monster, we had a Monster speaker cable, but you have the top of the line audio cords and Shunyata power cords, I don't think the bass will be transferable and we would not hear the same impact, because the speaker cable is negating whatever improvements. You'll get the brightness. Yes, you'll get the brightness if it's a lot of silver, but you won't get the muscle. You won't get the body if your speaker cables just are incapable of doing that. Does that make sense? So that's kind of how I view it. That's my argument. But I also understand the first cable in the system being the power cords, where the power, right? That's with the beginning of the entire operation, if you will. So if that's terrible, it doesn't matter what you do after that too, right? It can just completely disintegrate the presentation, the sound, the quality, everything. So it's an interesting argument to be had as far as which cable is the most important one. I can't argue with those that feel power cords are number one for a system, a well-designed system. I have had my fair share of power cords, and to your point, they all add a different thing. Warmth, speed, clarity, soundstage, impact, bass, they do it all. It's like, and for those, by the way, I want to know your take on this. Some people say that cables should not be used for tuning purposes, that is not the job of a cable. How do you feel about that?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's something to be said for it, but I don't. I think it's a little bit of an irrelevant argument, if I may say so, for at least my customer base, of our customer base, because they've all identified what sort of impact it makes, and they're all doing it anyway. An interesting. Which just popped up, if you're asking me what's more important on the server side of you. So then the USB cable would sort of be the interconnect or the power cord. If I were to have to choose between a high-end USB cable and a stock Walmart power cord, or a high-end power cord and a stock USB cable, I would definitely pick the high-end power cord. So I'd say that's more like 80% and the USB cable 20%. Just to, not that the USB cable doesn't matter, because it does. It makes quite but I'd say it's an 80-20% sort of thing. And that's obviously I'm a little bit focused on the source side of things.
Right, you are, yes.
So from that point of view, so speaker cables. Yeah, I have the range of Audio Quest. So their new series. So that starts at, I think, is that Tornado or something? Yeah. I don't know, on top of my head how it's called. And then up, all the way up to the Dragon, right. And then you sort of it sort of depends on the system which works best. So in some systems the Dragon actually doesn't work that well, the speaker cable, and the Thunder just sounds more, let's say, enjoyable.
Yeah.
So maybe that says something about the system.
Yes.
But the price difference is sort of major. I don't know, maybe 10 times or something like that. And yeah. I don't know exactly, but But that's sort of interesting, and it depends. So with the Magico A5s, just as an example, with solid state power amplifiers, I just like that entry level Audio Quest way better than the Dragon. I actually don't like the Dragon at all in that system.
But interesting.
With the panel speakers, the LC Fox panel speakers, the Dragon is just way, way, way better. So somehow that combines better. I don't know.
And right.
I do believe that the only difference is conductor material. I'm not exactly sure, so I haven't really looked into it. So again, I have some other stuff to do than back in the day. I would use every detail about every sort of person. Not there anymore. Not happening anymore.
Yeah, you got to put your effort with on what moves your needles, right? And that is right now continuing to push forward with your products. And I definitely understand that. So at the end of the day, I do believe that all of us use cabling to a certain extent to tune our systems, right? If we think about it, that's the reality. To say that a cable is extremely neutral and it adds nothing, no coloration, none of this, none of that, I don't buy that. I believe if your speakers are bright, the worst thing you can do is buy silver cables. Mm-hmm. So you're going to look for warmer cables, right? You're tuning at that point. That's what we're doing, right? You're tuning with cables. So
we don't have bass and treble control, so we have no other choice.
So, exactly. We avoid the equalizer. That's
about no loudness button.
So that's what we're doing. Cables are definitely part of that, and it's never going to stop. Well, I want to thank you, Emil. Thank you so much for this opportunity. I mean, I think you're doing great things over there with your team. I look forward to that new software, hopefully over the next few months, to see what else you're going to bring, what improvements will come about from this new software. I really want to say again, thank you for all the support. You're amazing. Your customer service is incredible. Highly recommended by me. I mean, and I don't think Emil is only doing this with me because I am here behind the computer and doing reviews on High End Audio. I think this is the same care that he would give each and every one of you guys that buy his product. So I'm nothing special. I'm just another customer, and it will be the same for you guys as far as the treatment and the support that he's capable of giving us. And I look forward to continuing to play with this server. I will give you my feedback as I push through with more cables, more power cords, hopefully a battery operated power conditioner to see what happens, and just provide and use me as a point of contact, of course, because I try a lot of things, and pretty soon my system will take on and will do a whole 360. I am planning to do a 360 come the beginning of the year. So my system will be something different and over the next 2 months. So, and again, the server will be here. It will be one piece that I can tell you will continue to be here, be part of that operation. So stay tuned for that. And I want everyone to know again that I am one more time very, very, very impressed with this machine, with this music server. I can't think of having a system without this piece. It really has added a tremendous amount of performance, taking my system to whole new levels. Again, I never really even bother to play with my local music files over the last 12 months, I would say, because every time I went to them, I felt like they were good, but I didn't want to be, playing with it because I didn't feel that it was that much better than music, than my streaming platforms. But now with this music server, out of nowhere, someone texted me and said, this person is an owner and he knows you very closely. Jay, try to get a couple of files in the machine. I do that with my system. I think you're going to be very impressed with what you hear. And I said to myself, last time I did that, I didn't really think so with another machine that I had, another music server, but I did. And I just, it's hard for me to go back to streaming right now. It really is for me. But again, system dependent, how resolving your system is, what kind of cabling, how your system is set up will definitely tell you the story. Some of you guys out there may not necessarily find a drastic difference between streaming and musical and local files. I do not have a reason to not believe you, but in my system, I'm hearing a great improvement with my files to the point that I'm feeling like just hitting play all files and sit throughout the weekend listening to every song that I have stored that I don't even know who they are. A lot of these artists, jazz, classical music that I'm not necessarily a fan of, but now I'm starting to enjoy and appreciate because of the clarity, because of the enhancements in the presentation, in the wow factor. You know, with that said, guys, thank you one more time for following me. Thank you for the love, for the support. Thank you, Emil, and your team. We will continue to be in touch. And maybe we do a part two series of this where we can get to see a little more about the factory and what you got going on over there behind closed doors, at least an inside peek, an inside look, if you will, for, you know, everyone else who's curious about your product. Because I did get a lot of questions about who you were. They knew nothing about you. And now it's starting to become a repetitive question. When are you going to put the interview up with Emil? I want to know more about what they do there. I want to know about, you know, their products and what's so special about it. So hopefully this interview has answered some of those questions, guys. I will continue one more time to provide you this level of information so that you guys can continue to stay tuned and bring you more from, of course, Emil and his team in a future video. But that's all I got for today. Thank you so much. Please subscribe.
Thank you.
And hit that like button. Thank you, everyone. I'm going to stop the recording now. Cool.